wat in de aankleed. Ja, het liep van hier. Lost a hell of a lot of weight, and then it was recast the pre-shrunk actor to it.
That's all right.
Yes. And he stayed for years, apparently. So there you are.
Stanley Bates.
Stanley Bates. Give this man at least 11 points out of 10. Well done.
It was later done.
Don't hear me, I will. Yes. Steady.
One girl matters.
Oh.
Let's not talk about it.
No,
let's just go back. Can you tell us a bit about your background and how you got into acting?
Oh my goodness me, how long have we got? My background is such that I didn't have any family at all, which were in the theatre or the entertainment business. All my relatives seem to have been in the Church of England. My father was a vicar. Both grandfathers were vicars. My godfather was a bishop. My uncle was a clergyman. And I had to become an actor. So there we are. But basically, because I was quite good at running away. I was quite good at sort of hiding. Life was very real and earnest for me when I was a child. Didn't have the most happy childhood, I suppose. So I suppose some inclination in me was to live by proxy in other people's characters. But when I was in my teens, I thought, well, this is something I really can engage with. And so I auditioned for the role. And about 6 months later, I was knocked sideways when I had a letter back from them saying that I'd been accepted. But I was a bit like the American girl who was given a place at a top drama school in New York. She said, I only did it for the audition. I only do auditions. But I did it for real. I went to RADA for a couple of years. Who was with me there? Anthony Hopkins was a contemporary of mine. And I trained as a classical actor. Shakespeare, Restoration plays, Chekhov. Wonderful. What am I doing playing a tin dog?
No.
That was his great nephew.
Okay, so a career on the stage then?
A career principally on stage, yes. I learned the craft, which is probably like driving lessons. You know, you can't drive when you've got an instructor sitting near you because you're doing everything by the book. But once you're out in repertory theatre, which I was for several years, you're out on your own and you're learning your craft, doing the job itself, which is marvellous. I started off at Frinton Repertory Theatre, £5, 10 shillings a week. And I was earning money doing what I actually wanted to do. It was fantastic. Then theatre continued. I did a lot of work in London as well, West End shows. I was in the West End for seven years. Then television sort of began. I was in what I like to call the golden age of sitcom in the 1970s. Rings on Their Fingers, Take Three Girls, Dad's Army. It was Dad's Army story. Sorry, with Ronnie Corbett.
I think there's going to be a lot of people the mention of Dad's Army there is.
A story called Sons of the Sea. Sons of the Sea. If you get the DVD set of Dad's Army, Sons of the Sea, you'll see me there playing a squaddy. But I have the punchline of the entire story, which I'm not going to reveal now.
And what do you remember some of the cast of Dad's Army?
The cast of Dad's Army, well, they were all alive.
That's an achievement.
It was quite an achievement. Yes, indeed. The cast. Well, wonderful. Arthur Lowe was very much what you saw. He was what I call a WYSIWYG actor. What you see is what you get. And he was a crusty, very crusty individual indeed. I loved John LeMessurier playing Sergeant Sergeant Wilson. He was, as you saw, totally and utterly vain. He tells a lovely story, if I have the time to tell it briefly. He had divorced Hattie Jakes.
That's the big mistake.
And indeed, he remarried, I can't remember the name of his new wife, but Joan, yep. My goodness me,
well,
get at least 15 out of 10.
No, I don't remember, because there was a TV play last year about her relationship with Tony Hanks.
That's right, it was all off in this train. Anyhow, John the Measurer had just been working with a couple of actors, and he'd taken his new wife for a walk near where they lived, Hampstead Hill, down there. And he could see these two actors coming towards him. And his memory for names was, oh my dear, I've just worked with these, oh God, what the hell? And they spotted him, they'd seen him. So there was no escape. We were getting nearer and nearer, he was getting nearer then. And eventually he got to them and he said, Matthew, lovely to see you again, great. And it's John, isn't it? Yes. Have you met, he had his wife with him and he couldn't remember her. There's room for two names, but not for three.
So, all those sitcoms?
All those sitcoms. Then what did I do? Well, I've done lots and lots of things. Voice work. I did quite a bit of voice work. When I wasn't working as an actor, it was sort of fill-in work. As a presenter for BBC Continuity Television, equally for Channel 4. Then I did some strange work for a chap called Jeremy Beadle.
Oh my God!
No, not your God, just Jeremy Beadle.
Yes, his team of pranksters.
I was one of his team of pranksters, which was absolutely marvellous. Except, you know, I didn't have enough insurance cover. I really ought to have had it. That was quite an education, because you had to get a certain result from the punter. You had no script. But all you had was your intentions to get them to do certain things. It's a wonderful acting lesson in doing improvised theatre. So it was improvised theatre for these poor people. We got them into all sorts of dreadful scrapes from time to time. But at the end of the day, of course, they'd signed a release form. And so they were perfectly happy for their scrapes to go out on television and show themselves being wound up by people like me. But at the end of one series, I spoke to the director, and he said, oh, John, he said, you should be doing more of this. You should be, are you going to come and work with us in the next series? So I said, well, I'm not a classical actor, you know, Shakespeare, Chekhov, and things like that. Oh, John, you really should. You see, the wonderful thing about you, John, is you're so ridiculously unidentifiable. So I thought, thank you very much. great confidence boost. Yeah, great confidence boost that was.
Okay, let's talk about that. So Agent got in touch and said, look, they're looking for a teen dog. And the name of the first dog was John Neeson.
Well, quite. I'd worked with a director called Derek Goodwin in Rep Theatre some while ago, and I would just happen to go down to the local pub here when I live in Ealing, and he was there. He was directing something called Zedcom at the time, way back then. And he said, oh, John, mate, lovely to see you, lovely. I might have got something for you. So I thought, oh, yes. The director will always say that when they see actors and haven't seen for ages. Do you believe them? And then my agent phoned up a fortnight later and said, well, the BBC have got something for you. Derek Goodwin has been through and he says, would you like to play two parts in Doctor Who? I thought, wow! It's been fantastic. So he said, well, there might be a catch. One of them is the voice of a virus. And the other one is the voice of a robot dog. So I said, well, I've played Bungle Bear, so I might, you know, be hung for a sheep as a lamb. So why not? And he's only in for one story after all. You know, so let's go for it. And then, of course, come to playing K-9. K-9 stayed with the doctor. And here I am, 33 years later, still playing K-9.
Do you think it might have been more interesting if John Scott Martin just as a giant frog?
Dear old John Scott Martin, bless him. John Scott, for those who do you know John Scott Martin? Grace Scorpio, lovely actor he was. But he noticed halfway through recording, he was inside this ghastly prawn costume. There were filaments of asbestos coming out of it. And they had to clear the studio. They got him out as quickly as they possibly could and cleared the studio. Yeah, poor John. Never seen him move so fast in the life.
Even when he was 118.
Yes, that's right. Pre-1 yes.
He was the old one who got the time. Yeah, okay, so. Tom Baker, Louis Jameson.
Yes, please.
Yes, yeah. Well, that's... Yeah. At that stage,
yes, I think I joined, I suppose, about three stories in after Louise had joined. How was it?
Well, I think Louise and Tom said a couple of times at the beginning.
It's always difficult, I think. Well, it's difficult for any of the companions coming in straight, because the character, in a sense, is preset. They've got to grow into it. Equally, I think the characters were written in such a way it was, what's that doctor? Help doctor, you know, and he is running around rough terrain wearing high heels.
That's just the doctor.
That's just the doctor. No, no, no. But equally, you see, the K-9, they say never work with animals or children, and the K-9 was sort of an animal. And I thought, well, Tom might not like being upstaged by this grey, noisy slug,
whatever
that
was.
Which he didn't. He didn't, very much. But we got a lot of out of it. We really did. And one of the reasons I think K-9 has lasted as long as K-9 has is that the original dynamics were built from the four actors. I was working with actors, eye contact, I was running around being K-9 in rehearsals. Obviously, I wasn't there when they were called. I was stuck away right back at the end of the studio with a mic like this and a pair of headphones and a screen. And all I could see was K-9 not doing what I'd done in rehearsals. Because the electronic signals that were fed into K-9 were on the same frequency as those going to the cameras. So whenever K-9 came into shot, the cameras just slowed up. It took a hell of a long time to sort out the technical problems. So in the studios, technical problems cost money. Time is money. When the dreadful teletype comes around, no overtime, no nothing. You know, it's got to be in the camera. So there's sort of pressures going on with this.
The introduction came out into that, in many ways it was, K-9 was Louise's pet more than the doctor, Louise's friend more than the doctor.
Yes, I suppose so. Leela had a great shine, which was lovely. Again, with K-9, I love the thing about K-9, he knows it all. He's an irritant. He's the grit in the oyster, to a certain extent. Which I enjoyed, because it took me... It related to a sort of pedantic, that was my personal and knowing things, I used to set questions to master mind.
Yes.
Way back. No, this is serious though, so I did. I set questions